Hi, I'm Gary Posekian here from the Mammoth Mountain Ski School to talk about the basics of skiing performance, the fundamental skills that make up any skiing maneuver. We can't improve our performance in any sport without first determining which skills need work. It's the same with skiing. Improve your skills and study the application of these skills, and your skiing will improve. The three primary skiing skills are edging, pressure, and steering. Virtually all movements in skiing can be described using these skill concepts. Balance in motion and flexibility, while not really skills, must be constantly improved as we reach higher levels of skiing performance. Body awareness, also a factor, refers to the skier's knowledge of what is happening to his or her body while skiing. For example, are you balanced properly on your skis? Do you bend at the waist, or do you sit back most of the time? Taken individually, each of these skills can be improved through a series of drills or exercises, which in turn will improve our overall performance. Let's take a closer look at the three primary skills: edging, pressure, and steering. Steering is just what it implies. It involves the actual turning of the ski with our feet and legs. Oftentimes, skiers try to use their upper bodies to turn. Improving this skill may involve some increased body awareness as we minimize our upper body movement and maximize our lower body movement. Edging involves our ability to control the angle of the ski's edge to the slope. By using our feet, ankles, and knees, we can tip our ski on its edge. A flat ski slides, and an edge ski has resistance. Factors such as how much, how quickly, and when we edge all make up this valuable skill. Pressuring the ski is the most complex skill of all. Mastering its subtleties requires many hours of practice and involves many elements. Most obvious is the transfer of weight from one ski to the other. We can also create or absorb pressure as we rise and sink throughout the turn. This is easily observed in mogul skiing as we absorb bumps and extend the legs in between. Finally, pressure involves leverage we can apply on the front and the back of the ski. Each of these skills is dependent upon the other. Skill level, terrain, speed, and turn design each may demand more of one skill over another. To review, skiing can be broken down into three basic skills: edging, pressure, and steering. Linked to these are the concepts of body awareness, balance, and flexibility. By practicing exercises developed to improve these skills, we can improve every facet of our skiing performance. For more information on skill development and improvement exercises, take a lesson from your professional ski instructor. For Mammoth Mountain Ski School, I'm Gary Posekian.
Hi, I'm Harry Peabody from the Mammoth June Ski School. In this tip, I'm going to discuss edging, one of the component skills that make up any skiing maneuver.
The term edging describes the application and adjustment of the angle between the ski and the snow. The main purpose of edging is to turn us and control our speed. Simply speaking, an edged ski creates resistance and deflection, and a flat ski skids or slips. Developing these skills involves the use of our feet, ankles, and knees as we adjust our edges according to our needs. It may be that a flat ski and skidding is required, even in advanced skiing. The best skiers have command of the full range of edging possibilities.
Let's take a look at some skill development exercises that we can use to improve our edging ability.
Side slipping involves the subtle use of our edges and helps us develop a good feel for our feet and skis. Begin with your skis edged into the snow and gradually begin to flatten them. As you start to slip, control your sideways movement by increasing or decreasing your edges as needed. You can use your poles to get started, or for balance if necessary. Notice the upper body is turned slightly downhill in the direction of travel, and the hands are in front of the body.
A variation of this exercise will help to improve the release and engagement of our edges while actually moving.
Start as before, but begin with a slow traverse with edges engaged. As you alternately engage and release the edges, feel the skis react as you move from a skid to a carve.
The falling leaf side slip adds another dimension to our edging, pressure.
Begin with a normal side slip, but rock forward onto the front of your skis, allowing the tails to wash out. Next, rock back on the tails, allowing the tips to wash out. As we alternate pressure on the tip and the tail, we side slip down the mountain as a leaf would float down from a tree. Remember to practice this facing both directions.
To improve edging independence, try the edge wedge, a good exercise for all skiers.
From a wedge position, alternately edge one ski and then flatten the other, making sure to keep the body facing downhill. As we veer left and right, do not turn the feet and skis. Rather, change direction solely from the edge ski. Notice the crisp, straight path left in the snow after the edge ski has deflected us.
For a more dynamic edging exercise, let's try 1,000 steps. We can really have fun with this one.
For this exercise, make medium to long radius turns and actively step your skis completely off the snow as fast as you can. Continue stepping all the way through the turn so that sometimes you're awaiting the wrong ski. Begin first on easy terrain and increase to steeper slopes or even moguls once you become more proficient. This exercise is an excellent way for you to feel your skis and edges work in different parts of the turn.
These are just a few exercises designed to improve our edging ability. For the when and why to edge, come and take a lesson from us at Mammoth June Ski School. I'm Harry Peabody. Ski safe and enjoy your stay.
Hi, I'm Julie Reitman with Mammoth Mountain Ski School. Have you ever been told to carve your turns more or that you skid your skis too much?
Skidding and carving, just what is the difference?
Skidding refers to both forward and sideways movement of the skis. Notice the extra spray as the skier moves sideways. Carving a turn means that the ski has little or no sideways movement as it moves forward. Both the front and back of the ski move through the same spot on the snow. Note the minimal spray and the smooth, even path of the ski. The shape and other properties of the ski help the skier vary the radius of the carved turn. Note that the waist of the ski is thinner than the tip and tail. We also know that the ski is flexible and bends as we ski. This exercise will illustrate the effects of these properties on a carved ski. Place the downhill ski on an extreme edge. As you begin to traverse forward, ride the edge ski without turning your foot. By riding the arc of the bent ski, I've actually moved up the hill. I turned by carving the ski into the snow. The curved path we have left in the snow mirrors the shape of the bent ski. In general, a beginning skier can use skidding to control speed and maneuver around the mountain. A racer will carve turns because it's faster and more efficient. Skidding is also a skill used by advanced skiers to negotiate narrow chutes and is used regularly by mogul skiers who both skid and carve to negotiate the changing terrain. All turns, even those we think of as being carved, are skidded to some degree. A carved turn is when the carving action exceeds the skidding action. Remember that carving is just one extreme of the skill of edging. Skidding, while valuable to the beginner skier for control, is also an integral part of advanced skiing. The best skiers have command of a full range of edging possibilities. Want to improve your knowledge of the carved turn? Take a lesson from us at Mammoth Mountain Ski School. I'm Julie Reitman. Have fun and ski safe.
I'm Michael Anthony from the Mammoth Mountain Ski School, here with a ski tip on the proper use of ski poles. Changing terrain, snow conditions, and varying ski maneuvers each may require a variation in pole plant technique. Used for stability and balance, the pole plant is a timing device used to coordinate action between the upper and lower body. Judging from the pole plant of the average skier, there appears to be some confusion about just how and why we use our poles. Let's look at some guidelines before we get into the specifics of correct pole usage. Proper skiing demands a relatively quiet or stable upper body as compared to the lower body. Excessive arm movement can cause negative reactions in our feet and our legs, causing imbalance. Watch the arm and pole action of this mogul skier. When his arm gets back, his weight is back, and he loses control. The hands should be carried comfortably, about waist high in front of the body, with the arms slightly bent. When not actually planting the pole, the tip should be pointed back to keep from sticking it in the snow and causing injury. This skier may be headed for trouble. In general, we turn around our poles, planting to the inside of the turn. The pole plant is primarily a wrist action, as opposed to an arm action. Think of the phrase, economy of movement. By using just the wrist, we can bring the tip forward and back quickly without disturbing our overall position. Ski poles play a more important role in short radius turns, such as in moguls or in steep terrain. In this demanding skiing, poles can be used to get you out of tight spots, help you regain your balance, and provide a good measure of confidence. By extending the pole downhill with the wrist, we can flex the arm as we make contact with the snow. The resulting rebound, which should occur simultaneously with the maximum edge set, can aid in a rapid turn initiation. Notice, after the turn has begun, the hand remains in front of the body. Forward movement carries the skier's hand over the top of the pole, and the wrist allows the pole to return to the neutral position. In longer radius turns, the pole is used primarily for balance and timing. Ideally, it should occur between the beginning and the middle of the turn, but it's not that crucial. In this pole action, the tip is lightly touched to the snow to avoid rebound and deflection. A hard pole plant at higher speeds can cause wrist and arm injury, or at the very least, will interrupt the smooth transition from turn to turn. That's the pole plant. Whatever your skill level, remember to keep the arms relatively quiet and the hands in front of the body. For more information on pole plants, come take a lesson from us at Mammoth Mountain Ski School. I'm Michael Anthony. See you on the slopes.
For many people, getting up after a fall can be a frustrating experience. Stiff ski boots and long skis restrict movement and make the simple task of standing up not so simple. Hi, I'm Larry Maurice with the Mammoth Mountain Ski School with a few methods to help you get up and back on your way after a fall. After a fall, the first thing we need to do is place our skis below us, across the fall line. Next, after we remove our pole straps, bring the hips as close to your skis as possible. Then place your poles above you, at the waist, with one hand at the basket and the other hand at the grip. Using the ski pole for leverage, pull yourself first over your skis and then up. There are a couple of variations of this method that you might find a little easier. Instead of having both skis close to your hips, extend the downhill ski until your leg is almost straight.
With this extra room, we can simply place our hands on the snow as we stand, or use your poles as before. If you have problems with your skis sliding as you stand, separate the tips. By pointing one ski slightly uphill and one ski slightly downhill, you can effectively block any sliding as you stand. Still can't stand up? There are a couple of other methods. This one, although not the most graceful, will work almost every time. Roll over on your stomach. With your head pointed directly uphill, knees bent, and skis in the air. Next, with your legs apart, place your skis on the snow with the ski tips pointing uphill and the tails together. Now, do a push-up to your knees and walk your hands towards your body until you can stand up. Once up, brace yourself with your poles as you step your skis around. If all this fails, take one or both your skis off, move to the side of the run, and put your skis back on. One final hint. Because of the slope of the hill, it can be difficult to put the downhill ski on. One method is to first put the uphill ski on, turn around and put the other ski on. And one other method, stand below your skis, cross your foot over, and step in. Well, there you have it. From Mammoth Mountain Ski School, I'm Larry Maurice. Just kidding.
Thank you. I think, from what I've seen, that the community has a new injection of life every time one of these special events. You see it written up in all the major newspapers all over the state, nationally, and some of them even filter out into the international area. So Mammoth's name has become standard with having the best events of whatever we have.
Probably the best race we've had all year, and you know, we need more races like that, and it helps when the towns get into it. So thanks a lot.
Take the road race, the bicycle race, with all of the vehicles we have to put on the road, employees that we put on the track, the timing devices we have to rent, all of the months and months of secretarial work, taking registrations and setting these people up in their positions and all, is very costly to us, and we don't begin to break even on that. The mountain bike is the same story again. Only a little bit more of that activity takes place up here, but it isn't enough to offset the cost. What do we get out of the motocross? We get the privilege of building the track, furnishing all the people for the starts, all the first aid people, all the radios, all the PA systems. Our ticket price barely begins to take care of just the cost of the employees that work there. It doesn't give you anything for the equipment, the water trucks, you name it. But those people eat in town, they stay in town, they buy their souvenirs in town. We're real lucky if we break even, and whatever the community gets, they make a profit on it. There's no comparison.
The track is great, you know, but it's the atmosphere up at Mammoth that makes it. If I was hurt and this race was going on, I'd come up here just to ride a bicycle, to hang out with the friends that I know, like the McCoys and everybody up here at Mammoth Mountain. Their positive attitude makes me positive and makes me want to race that much more. If I had my way, I'd be here every year till I can't ride no more.
The week after the U.S. Grand Prix, the Golden State hosted another special motocross event up in the Central California Hills. The star attraction, Rick Magic Johnson in his comeback race. Here's Brian O'Connor with the story of the 22nd annual Mammoth Motocross.
Located high on the eastern slopes of the Sierra Nevada is Mammoth Mountain Ski Resort, known for its spectacular skiing and ski racing. However, each June for the past 22 years, Mammoth Mountain plays host to a different kind of racing. Motocross, with the country's premier track and first-class organization.
When Greg LeMond, the young Californian, became the first American to win the Tour de France over the weekend, he became this country's best-known bicyclist. But he is by no means the only American who has developed a passion for two wheels. As NBC's George Lewis reports now, LeMond and millions of other Americans are never happier than they are when they're seeing life over the handlebars.
On the same weekend in this country, we found a group of people in the Olympic Peninsula of Washington State and in the High Sierra community of Mammoth Lakes, California, cyclists competing for $50,000 in prizes. One out of five bikes sold these days is an all-terrain bicycle or mountain bike. Naturally, somebody has come up with competitive events for mountain bikers. There are races through obstacle courses. And something called a kamikaze race. Contestants hurtling down a rock-strewn mountain slope at top speed. There are no awards for the most bruises. George Lewis, NBC News, Los Angeles.
That's nightly news for this Tuesday night. I'm Tom Brown.
eastern Sierra Nevada mountains of Central California will feature world-class cycling in the fifth annual Whiskey Creek Stage Race, part of the week-long
If we were to try to advertise for the first time, it would cost us a very large dollar. But now, the real advertising comes from the preceding year. Like the events that we had this year, there were several video tapes taken out there, and we don't have any idea where all those went. Where they went to ABC, CBS, or Primetime, or whatever. We don't really know what happens till days and months and maybe a whole year afterwards until the new season starts. And like the publications that are coming out this spring for the summer bicycling, you can pick up most any publication, there'll be a mention of what happened at Mammoth last year, and it's going to happen again this year.
Mammoth Ski Resort in California's Inyo National Forest is one of the world's top ski areas. But in the summer months, the resort sees action of a different kind, the World Mountain Bike Championships. Competitors are divided up according to age and ability. The overall winner is the one with the greatest...
The whole ski area, the town, everybody seems to be really into it, and they give it their 100% effort, and it's really shown to be a professional event here.
These are fantastic. They're run so well, it's really neat, and I hope things continue this way. This is really nice. They've put a lot of work and given us a lot of good things.
These special events are just the fraction of what we really do for the excitement of the community. We're in the background in several things like the 4th of July parade, the firemen's picnic, the schools, the playgrounds, even the summer festival, which is supposed to be a town event. We participate heavily in that also. So it isn't like we're coming with our handout. We just feel that if the community supports us in just these few things that we ask, that we can continue in doing all of the other things that we've been doing.
Ski Resort is located in the Inyo National Forest and operates under a special use permit from the U.S. Forest Service. This massive ski complex serves over 1.3 million skiers annually, more than any other ski resort in the nation. An average weekend day will see over 16,000 guests ski at our resort. Where do they all come from? Mainly Southern California. We're about a six-hour drive north from Los Angeles and about 3 hours south of Reno, Nevada. 38 ski lifts provide access to 3,000 skiable acres. Our 25-foot average annual snowfall produces a ski season that often lasts from November into July. These impressive attributes certainly contribute to our success, but it's the teamwork and dedication of our employees that bring our guests back year after year. The founding father of Mammoth Dune Ski Resort, owner Dave McCoy.
Looking back, I imagine you're wondering, how could anybody be around here for 50 years and still enjoy it? That is really easy. Just watch any morning, you'll see who's first out there on the hill enjoying the pack slopes, the powder, whatever it may be. We're all doing our job. We're all welcoming the guest. And at any time you see a guest puzzled about anything in the area, you just stop and help them. And your name tag, your uniform, and everything identifies you, and that gives you the privilege to say, may I help you? Mammoth June, you're here, you're gonna have fun, you're gonna do a great job, and I'm gonna see you out on the slopes having just as much fun as you. Have a good winter.
Our basic philosophy has never varied. We aren't trying to be the most glamorous or the most expensive resort around. We're simply trying to provide our guests with the best skiing experience possible. Realize that each of you will have a dramatic impact on our guests' vacation, be it positive or negative. It's not just the on-slope activities we refer to, but jobs behind the scene as well. Our guest vacation can be greatly enhanced by a shiny floor, a clean table setting, or a tidy restroom. The extra moment you take to answer a question on a busy day is what they'll remember. Mammoth June is one of the great ski resorts of the world. Take pride in the mountain and in your job. You're now a part of the Mammoth legacy that has steadily grown over the years. Let's take a quick look back at our humble beginnings. In the 1940s, a visionary young man named Dave McCoy believed that the Mammoth Lakes area had great potential as a ski resort. While working as a hydrographer for the city of Los Angeles, Dave developed a keen understanding for the weather and snow conditions in the region. After hauling his portable rope tow around to such places as Dead Man Summit and McGee Mountain, he finally settled upon Mammoth as the place to start a permanent business. By 1952, Mammoth had come a long way. They even had a paved road to the original warming hut, now a small section of today's main lodge. Before that, skiers were pulled to the rope tows by strange army surplus vehicles called weasels. It was slow going, but it was sure better than walking. Using his mechanical know-how and a small crew of followers, Dave rigged his own equipment, mixed his own cement, and built his first chairlift in 1955. From that seed grew the intricate system of lifts and facilities that make up the Mammoth June Ski Resort of today. Our most significant change in recent years has been the 1986 acquisition of June Mountain Ski Area near the town of June Lake. Located 20 miles north of Mammoth Lakes, just off Highway 395, or just 8 miles as the crow flies, this important addition provides clues to the future growth of our resort. June currently consists of 8 lifts, including the new QMC tram and detachable quads, chair 6 and 7. Facilities include the base tram house, June Meadows Chalet at Mid-Mountain, and the Hudson House near the base of chair 3. June offers complete skier services, including ski school, food service, rentals, ski repair, and a sports shop. Development plans include the expansion into the Hartley Springs area with the possibility of a lift system interconnect between Mammoth and June in the future. At Mammoth Mountain, a variety of services are available at several locations. Check your ski area brochure for specifics. Main Lodge serves as the administrative headquarters for Mammoth June Ski Resort. Among the many departments located here are the business offices, administration, and personnel. Main Lodge offers the full complement of skier services, including ski school, race department, ski repair, rentals, a large cafeteria, and a complete ski shop. Across from Main Lodge is the Mammoth Mountain Inn complex. Purchased in the late 1970s, this facility now includes a full-service hotel, restaurants and bars, and a daycare center. From Main Lodge, a short ride up Gondola 1 takes you to Mid Chalet. Completely rebuilt in 1982, Mid Chalet provides skier services to our guests while still on the mountain. From here, you can ride Gondola 2 to the top of the 11,053-foot summit. located on the back side of the mountain at Red's Lake, are chairs 13 and 14. Constructed in 1972, this opened up a whole new area, providing guests with western slope exposure and sunshine late into the day. At the base of these lifts, you'll find a snack bar, sun deck, and restrooms. In 1973, due to the growing numbers of skiers, Warming Hut 2 was constructed to serve as the Eastern Lodge Complex. Don't be fooled by the name. Warming Hut 2 is a massive four-story building located at the base of Lincoln Mountain. Offering services nearly identical to Main Lodge, the hut also includes a large convention area. In a normal year, the busy Warming Hut will actually sell more lift tickets than at Main Lodge. Continuing around the mountain, we come to chairs 15 and 24. Plans are underway to construct a large hotel and convention center, but for now, temporary facilities include restrooms and lift ticket windows. Lift ticket windows can also be found at several parking lot areas such as chair 2, chair 4, and chair 10. If you haven't realized it yet, Mammoth June Ski Resort is a big place. Look over a trail map and get acquainted with the area. Visit our various lodge facilities and ski around the mountain on your days off. Our visitors have plenty of questions and you must be prepared to answer them. As big as this resort has become, it maintains the atmosphere of a family-run business, because it's just that. At the helm, of course, is owner Dave McCoy and his wife Roma. General manager of Mammoth Mountain is Gary McCoy, while Candy McCoy is the general manager of the June Mountain operation. Controller of Mammoth June and longtime McCoy family friend is Nick Gunter. Personnel director Rusty Gregory oversees our 1,800 seasonal and full-time employees, and Tom Smith heads up the staff at the Mammoth Mountain Inn complex. Because of our relative isolation, Mammoth has become almost completely self-contained with our own trucking company, transportation department, and a snow removal department that is larger than Mono County's. Our huge maintenance garage services over 250 pieces of rolling stock, larger than many cities. By now, you have probably been assigned to one of over 50 separate departments. Each department depends on the other and requires a lot of dedication from you, no matter what your job. We all must work together to keep our resort running efficiently and effectively 7 days a week. Know your job and do it well. You'll be working alongside some of the top professionals in the business. Your attitude towards our guests and fellow employees can and will make a difference. For example, "Excuse me, sir," is better than "Hey, dude." Our guests come here to thoroughly enjoy themselves, and they do. They're escaping from their jobs and big city pressures. Help them to that goal, and you'll get caught up in the fun too. Show some personality in your job and create a fun, relaxed atmosphere. Pride, courtesy, teamwork, and enthusiasm. These are more than just words. Think about what they mean. Mammoth June can be very busy, producing some difficult situations. An occasional guest, frustrated by long lift lines and crowded slopes, may seem a little unreasonable at times. When this happens, stay calm and be patient. Courtesy and cooperation should be shown them whenever possible. You'll be surprised what a little smile and compassion will do for a difficult situation. As in any sport, there are certain risks involved in skiing. We strongly recommend that you maintain your own personal insurance policy or enroll in our seasonal group policy, which covers injuries incurred off the job. If you're injured on the job, your medical expenses will be covered by workers' compensation. If you witness an accident or are involved in one, report it on the incident report sheet available from personnel or ski patrol. This will serve as documentation in case the ski area receives a claim from the injured party. Your department supervisor will cover this important procedure in more detail. be aware that working at a ski resort can bring about some unusual circumstances. We expect you to anticipate bad weather, crowded roads, and slow driving conditions when coming to work in the morning. Leave earlier on these days so that you make it to work on time. Digging your car out is not a valid excuse for being late. You are responsible for opening the mountain to our guests, and as such, tardiness cannot be tolerated. There will be times when weather and snow conditions dictate fewer or more working hours on a day-to-day basis. In certain situations, you may be asked to assist other departments in performing jobs not specific to your own job description. Look upon these circumstances with enthusiasm. It's unselfish teamwork that keeps our resort running during heavy snowfall and adverse conditions. Well, that's Mammoth June Ski Resort. Keep in mind that service is our most important product, and you, our employees, are the resort's most important asset. We think you'll find it an enjoyable place to work and ski. You may develop friendships and memories here that will last you a lifetime. Most of that depends on you and your attitude towards your job, your fellow workers, and to yourself. Have a great season, and welcome to Mammoth June Ski Resort.